There is this wrong belief that attentions are going to solve all of our problems, but that's a wrong belief. That's a good model. It has very little inductive bias, and it's very good for big data, like the type of data that you have for language modeling, but they have their own drawback. Can somebody guess what that is? I mean, there is no free lunch.
They require a stupid amount of data, stupid big amount of data.
And for language modeling, we have. So let's say that's fine. And the type of data that you need for this are unlabeled. Forget about translation for a second. If you're doing language modeling, it's unlabeled data and you have a lot of it. There is no free lunch. These are not cheap models, attention. And we're going to see what is the cost. They are costly both in terms of memory and in terms of computation. Okay, and there is a thread of literature on trying to make transformers. The model that we just saw is called transformer. They want to make it more efficient. And let's take only the decoder part, because that one you're going to need for. You can use both the encoder part and the decoder part of a transformer for language modeling. And we're going to see both of them being used. But for this paper, let's take the decoder and try to make that more efficient. And there is a thread of literature on making transformers more efficient. I don't want you to understand every single detail of this paper, and I want to go through it really fast. But the idea is that there is no free lunch. For attention, what I just explained, I was expanding across the terms and explaining it that way because it is more intuitive. It's going to help us understand it better. But on your computers, this is what you do. Q is the, you put all of your sentence in a big matrix. You multiply it by a weight. That's going to give you Q. You take your sentence, multiply it by another matrix. That's going to give you K. That's query. That's key. And you have the value. And that's how you're going to code it on your computer. Query times key. It's going to give you your attention after the softmax, and then you're spreading your attention among your values. So that's how you're going to code it. But let's take a look at the sizes of Q, K, and V. You want to process things in parallel because you want to use your GPUs or TPUs more efficiently. So you're going to process things in batch. Each sequence is going to have a length, and the length, let's say it's D, it's L. And then each one of these matrices, they're going to have embeddings, and that's going to be dimension D. So it's going to be a tensor of size B by L by D, all of these matrices. B is the batch size, L is the sequence length, and D is the dimension of your query key or your values. Let's take a look at this, Q times K. Q times K, you're doing your summation over D. So that's the cost of that is order D. We don't worry about that. That's cheap. But then what's going to come out is going to be B by L dimensional after this operation. Then you do your softmax. For your softmax, you need to pay attention to every single other word in your sentence. So every single other word in the sentence, that's going to have a for loop. That's the size of L. You need to do it twice. The operational cost is going to be L squared. So it's quadratic in your sequence length. So the bigger your sentence length, the more operations you need to do. This matrix here is gonna have a big memory footprint. First of all, you need to store it, and it's gonna have a big computational cost. So this paper is gonna tell us how they want to make it more efficient. And it's not the only way of making it more efficient. So there is a thread of literature trying to do that, okay? Let's say L is 64K. 64,000 is the sequence length. And for language modeling, that's a reasonable size for your sentence length. Even if your batch is one, the memory footprint of computing and storing Q times K transpose is going to be 64K by 64K. Each one of the entries is a float, 32, and that's going to add up to being 16 gigabytes. So a very good GPU these days has around 48 gigs of memory. It means that perhaps you can process four batches, and this is just for this operation. So this is not gonna fit on most of the GPUs. Even on the best GPUs, you can process batches of very small size. So how do we make it more memory efficient? Don't compute this matrix altogether. Compute it one at a time. And this is exactly what we were doing in the previous paper, okay? Just compute your softmax and multiplication by VS and expand it out. Do it one at a time. So it's going to be QT dot product by KS. K is the key. You do your dot product. There is an exponential. You divide it by a normalization term, a summation of a bunch of exponentials. Okay, all of that term, you can put it in Z. The question is, what is your PT? PT, if you are doing the decoder part, you are not allowed to pay attention to the future information. So that's your PT. Any S that is less than your time, that's going to go inside this Z for computation of that softmax and doing this summation here for the outputs. And this is exactly your attention mechanism. So don't compute this and store it. Do it one at a time. It's going to be more memory efficient. There is this idea of locality sensitive hashing, LHS. We know that the computational complexity of computing this matrix and multiplying it by this V is going to be quadratic in L. There is a way to make it cost L log L. Okay. What is the observation? What is the big observation? The softmax is dominated by its largest elements. The more similar your query and key, the larger that's going to be. And that's going to give you a bigger softmax. What does it mean? You only need to focus on the keys that are closest to your query. So you have a query here for computing this Z. You just need to pay attention to the ones that are closest to Z. But how do you encode that? That's why you need a hashing mechanism. Your hashing mechanism is going to say that nearby vectors are going to get the same hash. If they're close, give them the same hash. Otherwise, give them different hashes. And you have a hash function. Now what you're going to do is you're going to change this PT. Your PT is all of the S that are less than T. You are still not allowed to pay attention into the future. But then you look at the hashing function. And if two vectors are close to each other, according to your hash, they are part of your P. And then you can reduce the computational complexity from quadratic in L to order of L log L. So I'm not going into a lot of details. A lot of details I'm glossing over, but that's fine. This is just to introduce to you that attention mechanisms are not for free. Even for back propagation, you have trouble. When you're doing back propagation, you need to know your forward variables to compute your backward derivatives. The trick is that you're going to divide x into x1 and x2. You process them separately. You have your attention here. You have your feed forward here. And y1 is going to be f of x2 plus x1. y2 is going to be x2 plus g of y1. Why did we do that? Because when you're going backward, you don't need to store the forward variables. You can just compute them. You can compute x2, you just solve it. x2 is y2 minus g of y1, and x1 is y1 minus f of x2. So if you divide your vector into two components and process them separately, you don't need to store any of your forward operations. You can just compute them when you need them in your backward pass. And this is called backpropagation without storing activations. What else? We are going to chunk our data, our sequences, across the position. So if you have a large sequence, don't process it at once. Process it in chunks. So you have a long sequence, and then you're going to have C chunks. And then you're going to process them independently. And at some point, they're going to talk to each other. There is a nice figure in the paper if you want to take a look. So what is the performance? Did we lose anything? If you use the regular forward pass versus reversible, reversible is more efficient than regular. But in terms of performance, you have the same performance. You didn't lose much. There is another idea that you can actually share the same weight that you are multiplying your sequences to obtain query and key. Basically, your query and key are going to be in the same space. If you do that, you're going to save some parameters, but then you don't lose much performance. There is another one. This is to study the effect of the hashing and how many hash buckets you need to have. This is the H function here, how many buckets you're going to use. And you don't lose much information, and most of them are doing okay, except for the two hashes. So that's probably too low for a bucket. And what is this axis here? This is the perplexity. I don't want you guys to be afraid of perplexity. We're going to need it for later on for language modeling. For language models, you have a sequence. We know that you're going to have a probability. If you take a log, it's going to become more clear. If you take a log, you're going to get 1 over n of the negative of the log of your probabilities. So this is square root of n now makes sense. You can think of it as geometric averaging, or you can think of it as arithmetic averaging if you take a log. And that's going to give you a perplexity measure. The perplexity is directly related to your probability of the sequence. And this is this y-axis. I guess I'm going to stop here. For those of you who want to leave, you are more than welcome to leave. For those of you who want to stay and ask questions, I'll be around.
I had this question about the last paper.
Sure.
So what I was trying to say is that in like the input size to the output encoding branch is some fixed size based on the length of that output, like the target output. And then you mask part of that because you only want to pay attention to the past, not the future. But then once that goes through that encoder branch and it goes into another encoder branch, it seems like it doesn't make sense to mask it again. Or maybe it does. I guess I'm just confused, like, why you would mask multiple times. Like, will it still be, say the original output size is size n, and then you mask the last three elements, then once it goes through that encoder branch, will it still be size n, and then you again mask the last three elements? That makes sense? It's hard to...
No, it's fine. The decoder, the probabilities that you're going to get out here, let's say you are here in your sequence, it's yt. Your sequence is now located at t, and you want to predict that word, okay? We know that your attention mechanism, these blocks, are going to give you sequences of length m, so it's going to be the entire sentence when you're doing your training, okay? So it's going to give you from 1 up until m. But then if you're sitting here, you need to cut your attention somehow. You are not allowed to pay any attention to information in the future.
Yeah, but what about like subsequent, like this depth in?
See, during training, when you're, this is the first layer, you're fine. That one you're understanding. There is no problem with that.
Yeah.
Okay, your problem is with the next layer. For the next layer, when you're doing your training, some information is gonna go from YT plus 1 and YT plus 2. When you're processing this, okay? Some information are gonna leak into the part of the block that you don't need to attention to.
Okay.
Because they share parameters, okay? Mm-hmm. So some information is gonna get leaked.
So you need to mask it again.
So you need to mask it again. Otherwise you're cheating. You're paying attention to, yes, it's not direct, but indirectly you're paying attention to your future through the hidden states.
Okay.
Yes, it's not direct. It's not exactly YT plus 1 that you're inputting, but it's a variant of YT plus 1. It's ZT plus 1 or HT plus 1 that is leaking to the next layer. So you're not allowed to pay attention to that.
Because in subsequent layers, the input to this output encoding will always be size M.
Yes, so it's always size M.
Okay, and then we need to remask each time. Okay.
Yes, see, this is size M goes in, size M comes out. A sequence of size M goes in, sequence of size M comes out to the next layer.
Why don't they do masked multi-head attention in that? Oh, I guess because that one's paying attention to that branch. Yeah.
You mean
I was going to say the second one in that.
This one.
Yeah.
Because you need all of them. You can pay attention to everything. It's not from 1 up until T, it's from 1 up until N.
Yeah, from the other branch. Okay, yeah.
So you know all of your sentence, input sentence.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Yes, sure.